tear off verse number 44. Luke, the 22nd chapter, verse number 44. If you have it, say amen.
Amen.
And it reads, "And being in an agony, he prayed more earnestly, and his sweat was as it were great drops of blood falling down on the ground." Amen. His sweat was as it were great drops of blood falling down to the ground. This morning I want you to think with me and pray with me for just a few minutes. This is Communion Sunday, so we have a few things to do after the sermon. Don't anybody leave without taking communion. But our subject this morning is drops of blood. Drops of blood. Ushers, you may sit. I want to speak to us today about what pressure is and what pressure does. On several occasions, my wife and I have flown from one city to another. When we could not get, I don't like to go up a couple of times. I like a non-stop. I just feel like the fewer times I go up, the fewer incidents can happen. But when we cannot get a direct flight, we flew on two different airplanes. We had two different flight attendants. We flew into two different airports. We had two different sets of seats. We had two different pilots. But on both flights, we would experience the same thing, and that is cabin pressure. As the airplane would lift into the air by the power of its engines, the higher the plane lifts off the ground, which is dominated by gravity, once airborne, the plane then becomes affected by the forces of pressure. There's less pressure in the air while you're flying than there is on the ground where you're walking. So in order to compensate, the cabin becomes pressurized to assist in the flight process. As you're elevated, you become pressurized. On a plane up high, you don't have a choice. You must be pressurized in order to sustain the cabin. In other words, the higher that you go, the more you will experience man-made pressure. Oddly enough, I have a friend of mine who once served in the Navy. And his duty as a Navy officer was on board a submarine. He tells me that when people are brave enough to go on a submarine, go under the water as part of a submarine unit, they too experience the same dynamic that we're talking about. And that is highly concentrated pressure. Pressure will begin, if you're on a submarine, that pressure will begin to press against the shell of that vessel. And unless there's enough, you know how pressure works, unless there's enough air pushing back against the pressure that's trying to come in against it, the submarine, just like an eggshell, would break or implode. In other words, the farther down that you go, the more you will experience unnatural pressure. I've been on airplanes. I've read about, I don't have any interest, going on to a submarine. But one thing I do know, and one thing I am familiar with, is this concept of pressure. Some of us experience pressure every day. Family life can make you feel pressure. Not having a job can make you feel pressure. Dealing with situations that are out of your control can make you feel pressure. Bills high and money low. I should have had a few amens right there. Can make you feel pressure. Dealing with illness, the illness that you have yourself or the illness of a loved one, can make you feel pressure. Being lied on and talked about by the same people you tried to help can make you feel pressure. Paying $1.89 a gallon $1.89? Y'all caught that? Okay. Paying $3.92 a gallon at the pump when you only got $1.10 credit can make you feel pressure. Filing your income tax at the last minute can make you feel pressure. Dealing with grandchildren that have been placed in your custody because your own children can't raise them can make you feel pressure. Being wrapped up, tied up, tangled up in a drug or gambling habit can make you feel pressure. Watching politicians maliciously attack the president like no one else in history can make you feel pressure. But you know, this has been going on for the last 200 years. One side or the other uses it as a distraction from what the real important issues are in order to whip up the us against them attitude that leads to divisiveness that is evident throughout the political history of our country. Donald Trump and the Republican politicians that are afraid to speak out against him are all suddenly reviving a time in our nation when if you were black and you were caught somewhere by somebody white, you had to show your papers. You'll get that when you get home. This is the most vile and reprehensible attack that our president among the many has had to endure while he's been in office. But what I like about Barack is that he has endured all of this pressure with a regal dignity about him that is befitting somebody of his caliber and his level of intelligence. I wish I had a witness. And like President Obama, just because you come to church, just because you read your Bible, just because you study your Sunday school lesson, come to Bible study, pay your tithes, sing in the choir, usher on the usher board, serve as a trustee, pray as a deacon, wear a cross around your neck, sit on the front pew, lift up your hands in worship, sit in the pulpit, I come to tell you that does not exempt you or disqualify you or discredit you. Pressure will wear you out. Pressure will slap the mess out of you. Pressure will kick your behind. Pressure will put you in the hospital. Take out your character. Pressure will drive you to drink. Tear up your theology. Kill your dreams. Make you weak. Put you in a strange frame of mind. Pressure will make you kick your dog. Yell at your children. Your wife. Get rid act like you've never felt any pressure. Some of you came in here today and you're about to bust wild. You're so pressurized, you haven't said good morning to anybody. You haven't smiled at anybody. You haven't said hello to anybody. You haven't hugged anybody. You haven't lifted up your hands in the church. You have not patted your feet. All because you're under pressure. We're not alone. We're not alone in our circumstances. Dr. Luke, who is the only medical doctor who writes a book of the gospel, clinically takes us this morning to the Garden of Gethsemane. Dr. Luke, who was a practicing physician, a professional, if you will, is writing his soap. He's writing soap notes on the situation that Jesus finds himself in. Dr. Coretta Murphy will tell you that soap notes are used by doctors when they write on their patients' charts. I would ask Coretta to tell you, but I'll tell you, S stands for subjective. O stands for objective. A stands for assessment. And P stands for plan. Dr. Luke notes that he wants to take note of Jesus' prayer time in the garden. He's nearing his arrest. He's about to be put on trial. He's about to face the crucifixion that is going to occur between Palm Sunday and Good Friday. Jesus is not only going to pray, but the Bible says he takes two of his disciples along with him. Can I get a witness in the house? Bible says that he is in agony. That word, agony, is really interesting to me because Jesus, like many of us, has multiple things on his plate. He's just left celebrating the Lord's Supper. Judas is about to betray him. Some of his disciples are secretly desiring more power than the other disciples. He's just instituted a new program called the Lord's Supper. He's walked now to the Mount of Olives in order to get time for private prayer. He recognizes that two of his spiritual heirs have gone to sleep on the job. He has to inform Peter that before the cock crows twice, he will deny him three times. Poor people want him to feed him. So-called church leaders want him dead. But somehow, with all that's on his plate, Jesus finds the time to pray. Let me roll that back. With all the stuff going on in the life of Jesus, he finds time to pray. One more time for good measure, because you didn't get it. With all that he's got going on in his life, stuff that would make us lose our minds up in here, Jesus makes time to pray. Here we are, beloved, with covert racism against the president as the rule of the day. Tornadoes are raining destruction throughout parts of the South. Gas prices are through the roof. Our economy is in a recession. We're fighting three wars. Social unrest is everywhere. Nuclear reactors are imploding. Trouble in our homes. Dysfunction in our families. Communities covered with crack cocaine. Legislatures that are ineffective. A Congress that cares more about re-election than about the poor. Somebody needs to take the time to pray. I know you're busy, but pray. I know you got meetings, but pray. I know you're a businesswoman, but pray. I know you got a wife and family, but pray. I know you think you're a bag of chips and all that, but pray. Tuesday at prayer meeting. Somebody by now should be asking Pastor Rocky, the bars have a happy hour. How come we can't have a prayer happy hour? Somebody by now should be saying, Pastor, why can't we shut down the choir, shut down the singing, and pray for an hour that God will cover our families, cover our finances, cover our home, cover our community, cover our children, cover everything in our lives. Just shut it all down and pray. I'm glad you asked that question. Stand up on your feet wherever you are. Stand up, stand up, stand up. Join hands with people around you. Join hands with folk around you. Somebody in your group become the leader and start praying right now. Somebody just start praying in your group. Just start praying. Pray, pray, pray. Somebody start praying. Pray, pray, pray. Pray for the church. Pray for your homes. Pray for our membership. Pray that God will bless us. Pray that God will cover us. Pray for the Lord to strengthen you. Pray for healing in our bodies. Pray for those who are sick among us. Pray that God will work a miracle in this place. Pray. 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 God is able to do great things, and we ought to lift up His holy and precious name. Somebody's going through hard times in their family. Somebody has lost their job. Somebody is looking for a job. Somebody is about to have a baby. Somebody in this place is about to be released from their burden. Somebody in this house needs God to cover them. We got people who are going crazy because they don't know where their next dollar is coming from. Pray, 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 pray that God will set free those who are bound. Pray that God will deliver the brokenhearted. Pray that God will set free the captive. Pray that God will do so many great things in the life of our church. Is anybody praying? Is anybody praying? Pray, pray that God will bind the devil, that He will release His Holy Spirit in this house, that we will be able to dance the holy dance, that somebody will be able to prophesy. Prophecies will go forth. The boldness of the Holy Spirit, the release of all the gifts in the house of His kingdom. Pray that God blesses Greater Friendship Missionary Baptist Church. Pray that God will continue to be a hedge around our building. Pray that God will lift up those whose heads have been bowed down. Somebody's discouraged, but they're going to leave encouraged because of your prayer. Somebody has their head bowed down, but they're going to leave with their head held up because of your prayer. Pray. We know God is able right now in this place to do so many great things. Pray. Pray for members who decide to come to church once a month instead of every Sunday morning. Pray that God will continue to be a blessing all around us in every situation, in every circumstance. Pray for the Lord to bind up the enemy who tries to attack us in this place. Somebody ought to pray for God to do miracle working power in this place, show signs and wonders in His house. Pray. Hallelujah for what God is getting ready to do. Now put your hands together all over the church. Come on, put your hands together all over this house. Put your hands together for the victory that God will give you because of your prayer. I've always been taught that Jesus is perfect, and I still believe that He's perfect this morning. He has no sin. He has no guile. He doesn't even contain the sin gene, because His birth was not made possible by the seed of a man, but by the seed of the Holy Ghost. He's not only perfect spiritually, but he is perfect morally. He's never been found guilty of any legitimate charges. He's never received a ticket for speeding with his camel. He's never smoked a joint. He's never took a hit off crack. He's never smoked opiates. He's been never found in a compromising sexual scandal. He's never gone inside of an ABC store. He is morally perfect. He's spiritually perfect as well as morally perfect. But Dr. Luke makes a diagnostic that almost suggests that he's physically got some issues going on in his life. But before we go down that path, let me review a couple of things very quickly. Dr. Luke is the only writer who is a practicing physician. Dr. Luke is the only writer that describes this nugget of truth in all four of the Gospels. Dr. Luke has watched Jesus at great length and can address this circumstance. Dr. Luke says that Jesus, who is under great pressure, now goes in to pray. Watch what he does. He puts space between himself and his disciples. And he goes into the Garden of Gethsemane to pray. You need to check this out. Because when you get under pressure, you better put some space between you and people. Between you and your circumstances. Put space between you and your situation. Remember, everything that Jesus was concerned about was not in the garden, but he was concerned about those things that were away from the garden. You may need to get out of your house and go to pray. You may need to get away from your job at lunch hour and pray. You may need to get away from some of your friends and pray. You may need to get away, watch this, from some church folk. Such intensity that Dr. Luke says he prayed so hard that allowed me some room for theological imagination. It reminds me of one of my patients, Dr. Luke says, that was suffering from a rare condition. The clinical term for what Jesus did in the garden with drops of blood issued from his sweat glands. The clinical term is hematohydrosis. And that particular term means that around the sweat glands, there are multiple blood vessels. And they're in a net form. And under the pressure of great stress, these blood vessels will constrict. And then as the anxiety passes, the blood vessels dilate. And they dilate to the point of rupturing. The blood then goes into the sweat glands. And as the sweat glands are producing lots of sweat, it pushes this blood to the surface. And the blood comes out like droplets. The blood begins to mix, if you will, with the sweat. Notice what Dr. Luke noticed when he saw Jesus alone. He said it was the blood and not the sweat that he saw. I need to tell somebody that the blood of Jesus is salvific. The blood of Jesus can wash your sins away. The blood that came from his body was not the last time he would shed some blood. He shed blood when they whipped him all night long. He shed blood when they broke open his skin with whips made of bone and steel. He shed blood when they crowned him with 32 thorns around his head. He shed blood when they put a nail in his right hand. He shed blood when they put a nail in his left hand. standing where I am this morning. Every time I think about the pressure of the blood, I think about the pain of the blood. Every time I feel pain in my own body, I think about the blood. Every time I'm lied on and misunderstood, I think about the blood. Every time I'm tossed to and fro, I think about the blood. Every time I'm under great pressure as the leader of this church, I think about the blood. The really great weight upon Jesus was the knowledge that he soon would have to bear the trauma and the guilt of all of our sin. But I have a witness today that wrote in the Bible some good news. And although he could have anesthetized his own pain, he chose to go to Calvary. He had blood that was dripping from his body. But I got good news that came from the scriptures. It said he was wounded for our transgression. I wish I had a Bible reader. It says he was bruised for our iniquities. That the chastisement of our peace was upon him. And by his stripes we are healed. Can I get a witness? I want to thank Jesus for shedding his blood. Thank you, Lord, that your blood ran from Calvary. Thank you, Jesus, that great drops of blood fell from your body. I wish I had a church. Well, let me tell you a little story, and I'll take my seat. One night at a church service, there was a young woman that felt the tug and the pull of God upon her heart. So she got up from her seat and she went down to the front of the church and she responded to the call, and they said that Jesus as her Lord and her Savior. This young woman came from a very bad past. She used to be on drugs. She used to drink all kinds of alcohol. She even sold her body into prostitution. But there was a change in her life. And as time went on, she became a faithful member of the church where she lived. She eventually got involved in ministry. She started teaching children in Sunday school. And it wasn't long before this young faithful woman had caught the eye of the pastor's son. As the relationship grew, they started making wedding plans. And that's when the problem started. You see, about one half of the church didn't think that a woman with her kind of past ought to be married to the pastor's son. The church began to argue. The church